So before we resume the session, now focusing on international criminal law, a few words to all of you about the outcome of the conference. In as much as we have received many questions, which is logical. Of course, we intend to publish the proceedings of this conference and to take advantage of this big bunch of very nice papers and topics that you have tackled along the conference and before. We have already mentioned the project to Oxford University Press, which as a matter of principle was interested in the book, but now, of course, we have to make a book project and to submit it formally to Oxford University Press. This is why we are going to write to you next week to confirm whether we are ready or not to submit a paper for the sake of publication. And you have to confirm both your intention and the exact title of your paper. And the absolute deadline for the publication will be the 31st of March for the final version of your paper. Of course, in between, you can always send drafts so that we can help you and maybe review and work on your paper, but the absolute deadline will be 31st of March, and we would like the book to be published far beyond the first anniversary of this conference. So thank you for your understanding, and of course, you're more than welcome to take part in this publication. Thank you very much.
I remember in the early and mid-1990s, I was only five then, but there was the study of international criminal law was about, started from 1907 to around about 1992, and then from then onwards. So everybody perceived international criminal law through a very narrow lens, and that was the understanding for some time. And every time a new case came up, like Tadic, everybody jumped on the case, and you had 100 articles within a week. Nowadays, there's an outpour of jurisprudence from a number of tribunals around the world. I don't even know what they are now. And so, there's so much output that eventually international criminal law became what international lawyers aspired to, but they always feared, which is that it would be hijacked by criminal lawyers. And German criminal lawyers jumped on the bandwagon, and they made it a dogmatic international, or should I say, German criminal law. Although for me, that was the showstopper. But for the discipline itself, it was a good thing. And because international criminal law had to become, at some point, more specific to kind of make a reality those principles that we share in criminal law about the specificity of the charges, the specificity of the law as it applies, and so forth. So maybe bad for me, but I think good for the discipline overall. I think one of the themes that comes out from the first panel is that we haven't really found a tribunal that has failed in itself. Sure, some tribunals do better than others, but none that has really failed. So the theme of the first of this first session is more about the problems of impunity. So it's not what the tribunal itself as an institution does, but all those things that the tribunal hasn't been able to take within its jurisdiction and within its ambit. And I think this is reflected in all three papers. So the first paper is by Hae-jin Kim, who is a postdoctoral fellow at the National University in Singapore, specializing in public international law. And before joining the Faculty of Law at Singapore, she was in a number of institutions, including the Office of the Presidency at the ICC in The Hague, the Constitutional Court in Korea, and the National Human Rights Commission of Korea. Her paper is entitled Ending a Culture of Impunity, a History of the Use of International Judicial Means for the Punishment of Atrocity Crimes in Asia.
Please note the change in the title. I'm sorry. Yeah. Hi. Thank you again for organizing this wonderful conference. It took me almost 14 hours to come here, but it's, I'm very happy that glad that I made it because I learned a lot from all of you. So thanks again. So in this year, international criminal adjudication is maybe the most controversial court arrangement in international law. ICC was greatly celebrated as the first permanent court of this kind. In about 18 years, 124 states have ratified the Rome Statute. But as we all hear from the news, three African states' parties officially announced withdrawal from their plans to withdraw from the statute. And just like just last week in Asia, President Duterte said in his speech that the Philippines might join this pullout. It seems that in the minds of many governments of ICC parties, not just in Africa, doubts are growing about the very notion of having international criminal adjudication, at least in its current form. In Asia, there is another issue or signs of failure that I want to discuss more in this talk. In describing Asian attitude towards the creation and use of international criminal prosecution, some keywords have been silence or lack of interest. So, for example, in 2002, when the court just started its operation, 76 states ratified the statute. Having only 8 parties, Asia was the most underrepresented region. In 2005, only 12 out of 100 state parties were from Asia. So I was wondering about this region-wide reluctance or lack of vibrant national discourse about international criminal adjudication in Asia. And so I look back in the history of making international criminal law and adjudication. My paper examines where Asian states were standing throughout the development of international criminal law. I wanted to find some regional context or common experience in Asian states that altogether helped or hindered their participation. First, let me date back to 19th century when the initial proposal was made to create an international criminal court and states finally codified laws of war in The Hague. In Asia, international law, or at that time called laws of civilized nation, was broadly understood as meaning colonial expansion of the Western powers, or to some extent modernizing tool for the better. Only Japan at the time maintained full independence by quickly taking modernization reform and accepting westernized legal rules and institutions. Japan wanted to have external recognition of Japan as a civilized nation. So to demonstrate her civility, Japan used international law as an important means. It was the first country in Asia who joined intergovernmental organizations originated from the West and attended policymaking meetings in Europe. It was the first one that made explicit theoretical justification for its wartime conduct by referring to laws of war. In other Asian states, political elites maintain isolation policy, rejecting to accept Western commodities or institutions like international law, or their countries were already under colonial rule and lost ability to pursue independent diplomatic policies. So, in the eyes of Western states, or according to writings of Western scholars at the time, Japan was arguably the only civilized nation in Asia. The status of civilized nation was almost a prerequisite for participating in international policymaking at the time. So when the Hague Conference were held in Asia, only Japan, China, and Siam were invited. In this early codification, most Asian countries could not meet the Western standards of civility and were considered unqualified to conclude treaties with a civilized nation on the basis of sovereign equality. The majority of states, given their geopolitical status as colonial or quasi-colonial state, were not invited to send delegations to the conference. So they did not have ways to channel their interest in lawmaking. Until the mid-1940s, there was no significant change to this situation. Only after the Second World War, international criminal adjudication became formally institutionalized. Two post-war military tribunals were established to punish war criminals according to the terms agreed by victorious nations. Especially Tokyo trials introduced the concept of international criminal accountability to the Far East region. Many Asian states, not just Japan, directly and indirectly experienced emerging system of international prosecution, mostly for the first time. In Japan's view, the whole process of trials was victor's justice imposed by the Allies merely because of Japan's military defeat. So Japan's own sense of unfairness and victimhood is reflected in its controversial understanding of wartime history and responsibility. On the other side, there were Asian countries that suffered atrocities during the war as Japan's occupied colonies or under its military control. From their view, the tribunal's legitimacy is criticized in a different context. As victims of atrocities, their people clearly had substantial interest for the trial. But Tokyo Tribunal provided a highly selective form of justice for the Allies. The framework of accountability was geared to the prosecution of specific atrocity cases, ignoring other crimes committed in many Asian countries by the Japan's Imperial Army. So impunity was tolerated for mass killings, rape, and sexual slavery committed in occupied territories. So from the perspective of both sides, the Tokyo Tribunal left post-war Asia with a sense of unfairness and dissatisfaction about what is called international criminal justice. And such failure and continued impunity had major impact on the victims of the atrocities. And the last phase I want to talk about includes Cold War and until the formation of ICC. There was intense political and ideological tension during the Cold War, and the mission of creating an international criminal court fell in the years of silence until this agenda re-emerged in the late 1980s. The Cold War context alone, however, does not fully explain how most Asian states were not centrally involved in the process of developing international criminal law over the succeeding decades. More important context is what these countries went through during this period. I find the first common context from the region-wide political instability with mass atrocities. During this period, most states in Asia were under extreme political instability, coupled with recurring atrocities that led to mass civilian casualties. I will not go into detailed cases in this talk, but domestic instability stemmed from various situations, including liberation movement, civil war, and military dictatorships. In this national turmoil, non-interference became the basic principle for interstate relations in Asia. And this is well reflected in ASEAN documents. In the eyes of many Asian governments, the growing interest in international prosecution was not really pertinent to regulate their domestic affairs. The second common context is a culture of domestic impunity for atrocity crimes committed in the past. In many post-conflict and transitioning states in this region, national courts often fail to prosecute serious international crimes, particularly those committed by the nation's political and military leaders. Easily evading accountability, they continue to have impact and power in their government. And such widespread domestic impunity is almost always a major obstacle that could hinder the pursuit of international justice regarding similar situations involving atrocities. We are now back again to the ICC. International criminal adjudication had a critical point when states finally adopted founding treaty of the ICC. The codification conference was held in Rome for 5 weeks, and 27 countries in Asia sent delegation. It was an unprecedented for Asia to make such presence from beginning to end of negotiation. And this time, there were no civility standards or colonial conditions that could prohibit them from participating. And almost 50 years had already passed since the end of Tokyo Tribunal. So in theory, Asian states have substantial time to examine and test various aspects of international criminal accountability. But as I pointed out earlier, when we look at the early status of ratification in Asia, little change was made in the region-wide reluctance to recognize such accountability system. So then why no real breakthrough in Asia? Of course, domestic politics always have something to say in this, but I also want to highlight that many Asian states did not have sufficient financial, technical, and human resources to be used for international justice projects like this. For example, at the Rome Conference, many countries in Asia were able to send only a handful or one or two delegates. It is doubtful whether they could thoroughly examine a long legal text containing 116 articles with 1,300 brackets. They could, but not within a short period of time. Like many observers point out, smaller delegations could not cover all concurrent meetings and working groups during the negotiation, and it might be difficult for them to make fully informed decisions on the matters that have strong implications for their sovereignty and national legal system. So finally, I want to say a few words about how to promote Asian participation. I think the most important strategy must be to enhance states' own ability and willingness to adjudicate international crimes. Again, the role of political leader is very important, but this goal can also be facilitated by local legal experts and more bottom-up advocacy, invoking international criminal law with better understanding of our system. And if we see international criminal law in historical context, there is no such thing like linear progress or quick fix to the failures and misconceptions we had. But I think there will be some lessons to learn from understanding when and why states reject or hesitate to join international adjudication system. Thank you.
Eugene, thank you for your paper. I think it's obvious and what criminologists usually say, criminology hasn't really been used extensively in the international criminal law literature, but to fight impunity, we need a zero tolerance policy, but also a bottom-up approach. And this is more clear, especially in corruption, where empirical studies have shown that corruption can only be defeated as minor corruption rather than taking over, taking steps against leaders, grand corruption. Our next paper, I'm sure we're going to hear it, is by Patricia. There's only one vowel in your name. Sorry, two. Gritsevic, who's an assistant professor in the section of strategic studies of the University of International Relations at Warsaw. And she's a lecturer at the Human Rights School organized by the Helsinki Foundation of Human Rights. And the title of the paper is Hidden in the Glare of the Nuremberg Trial, the impunity for the butchery of Vola as the greatest debacle of post-World II prosecution of international crimes.
On the 1st August 1944, the Warsaw Uprising started. It lasted till 2nd October 1944. The uprising was eagerly awaited by the Polish population, but also it was expected by the Germans, because it offered a pretext to finish the Polish problem and to destroy Warsaw. The losses of Polish sides in this Warsaw Uprising, which is much criticized if the decision about it was good or not. But if we just look at the numbers, we can see that about 16,000 soldiers, members of the Home Army, were killed, but the civilian losses were much more higher. Historians estimate that even almost 200,000 people died in result of the Warsaw Uprising, and more were deported from Warsaw. Just to show you the scale, just before the Warsaw Uprising, about 900,000 people were in Warsaw. When the Warsaw Uprising is ended, only 1,000 people are still in ruins of Warsaw. But what I would like to focus not on all crimes committed during the Warsaw Uprising, and crimes were committed by both sides, because I must admit that also Polish soldiers didn't respect any prisoner of war rights. They were killing wounded and sick as a revenge for the previous crimes, which is not, of course, the justification. But I would like to focus on the massacre of Wola, one of the boroughs of Warsaw, in result of which about 40 to 60,000 people were killed, and only on one day, on the bloody Saturday, on 5th August, 20,000 people were killed at once. That's why historians, and I'm not talking only about Polish historians, they describe the Wola massacre as the biggest single crime committed against civilian population committed during the whole Second World War. When the Warsaw Uprising started, the task to finish the uprising was assigned to Bach Zalewski. But at that moment, Bach Zalewski was in Sopot, which is in the north of Poland and quite far away from Warsaw. So fighting with uprising was a job of Hans Reinefart, SS general. And Reinefart, with the full consent of other commanders, including Wormann, decided to start attack against Wola and Ochota on 4th August. It must be stressed that at that moment there were no major fightings in this area. And in Wola, there were not even many troops of partisans. On the 5th August, the massacres started, and immediately the special commander was created to burn all the bodies. And the reason was not to cover maybe the traces of the crime, but just to prevent the outbreak of the epidemic of the disease. When Bach Zalewski is coming to Warsaw, and he came on 5th August of 1944, he easily could notice that civilians are killed. And he asked Reinefart, "Are you killing women and children?" And Reinefart, "Yes, because this is the Hitler order." And Bach Zalewski, "Let's stop. Do not kill women and children. You can kill all men, but not children and women. This part of population should be deported from Warsaw." What is also very striking when we read the testimonies of survivors of Wola massacre, which were verified after the Second World War before the Polish courts, you can easily see that Germans, they were not only killing people, but they were also verified if somebody survived. If somebody survived, it was killed. He, she was killed immediately. Also, when parents were asking that, "Please kill first my children and then me," they on purpose were killing parents, and then when children were totally devastated, they started to kill children. You could also see from the famous and much cited testimony of Václav Šacheta that even babies in the baby pram were killed, a few months old babies. So definitely this what happened we can call as a war crime in light of International Military Tribunal Charter, because we can easily see that murder, ill treatment or deportation of civilian population was called as a war crime, as well as wanton destruction of cities. Also, there is no problem with qualification of those crimes as crime against humanity, as we can see the murdering, extermination of civilian population linked to the war, and there is no question that this was linked to the war, could be qualified as crime against humanity. But I think that also we cannot exclude the genocide qualification if we take into account some statements on behalf of Nazi authorities. For example, Himmler, in his speech in September 1944, he was stressing that this uprising gives a pretext to finish the Polish question. And as you can read, the Poles themselves will cease to be a problem for our children and for all who will follow us. If you add to this the famous Hitler's and Himmler order, according to which every inhabitant of Warsaw must be killed and no prisoners should be taken, and the plan was to raise Warsaw to the ground, this was done by Germans, because and this destruction of Warsaw was also done after the Warsaw Uprising during the 3 months, and during this period 85% of Warsaw was destroyed, as you can see from pictures. If you take this into account, those facts, you can think about genocide qualification, of course, with question mark, because also we must check if the aim was to kill a nation group as such, or maybe this was just to teach the lesson, Poles, to not organize this kind of uprisings in the future. But just recently, historians, they revealed that according to the Nazi documents, the plan was to kill 85% of Polish population. We can wonder if this is sufficient just to say that this was genocide or not. And also, taking into account the limited geographic scope of the massacre of Wola, if we take into account the jurisprudence of international tribunals, we can find out that usually this geographic scope was, if it was limited, it was accepted if the whole population which was in the hands of the perpetrators was eliminated. In case of Poles, no, this was not the case, just the population of Warsaw was killed. And also, of course, there is a problem if we can apply genocide convention retroactively, but I leave this question. Certainly we can say that those who were engaged in those crimes, there was legal basis to prosecute them. We are talking about the responsibility of those who were ordering those crimes, so also Hitler and Himmler, but also those who were transmitting and implementing this order, like Guderian, Reinhardt, Forman, Bakselewski, and Rainer Fahrt. We are talking about the responsibility of those who were executing orders. And also these were not only SS, not only Wehrmacht, but also civilians, police, which was part of so-called Reinefart group. And also, even if we agree that Bakselewski should not be responsible for all crimes because he stopped at certain moment killings of women and children, still he could be prosecuted for non-prevention of some crimes and for not punishing perpetrators. Moreover, Bakselewski, he even asked for the promotion of Dirlewanger and Reinefart, who are considered as the main perpetrators of the cruelest persons in the whole bunch of perpetrators of the Wola massacre. So that's why we can think a little bit why this kind of massacre was not prosecuted in Nuremberg and in subsequent proceedings. The problem was that the London Agreement, according to the London Agreement, only representative of the big powers were in the bench, were on the side of prosecutors. And this was a big failure for us, big disappointment, how it was called in this conference. It also, there was a clear division of tasks between prosecutors. So for example, for crimes committed on the territory of Poland, the Soviet prosecutor was responsible. And Soviet prosecutor, he wanted to focus on the crimes committed on the territory of the USSR. Also, just to expose crimes committed during the Warsaw Uprising was quite dangerous for the USSR, because it would show that USSR didn't intervene. The Red Army stopped on the right bank of the Vistula, and they didn't even allow the Polish groups which were included in the Red Army to help partisans from the Warsaw Uprising. This also is very important, that when the United Nations War Crimes Commission is working on the list of people who should be indicted in the Nuremberg, there we have the problem of two governments and in Poland. And UK stops to recognize the Polish government in exile. They recognize the communist government, and it happens in July, and then the Polish authorities can send its representative only in October. So it was just after the indictment was prepared. And also, because of the Warsaw Uprising, we could not send evidence to be collected by this commission. And I think we forget about it, that in the Nuremberg trial, the focus was on crime against peace. We can say that even it was the American obsession to focus on this. So not only war crimes, but even the Holocaust was just a background, was just additional proof of the criminality of the war as such. And for example, Bach, Zalewski, and Reinefeld, they were treated as very crucial witnesses because they were willing to testify against others. And this was also, we can see from Nuremberg proceedings, that many accused people, they were shouting, he has more blood on his hands than we are, what we are doing here. But also you can ask, if it didn't happen in Nuremberg, maybe we could deal with this failure afterwards. And Telford Taylor, in subsequent proceedings, in subsequent trials in Nuremberg, he considered a case about destruction of Warsaw. But he resigned and he said, okay, let's give this case to Poles, because Poles created a special tribunal to deal with the major criminals. But the problem was that afterwards, US and Germans, they denied extradition of the main perpetrators. Because majority of perpetrators were military men, they were considered as very useful people, people who could be very useful in possible future Third World War. So that's why military men, you could see this after the Nuremberg, they were they avoided any proceedings against them. So we could argue that there was this lack of cooperation between Poland and the Western world. Also, this organizing this kind of prosecution would expose this Soviet role. And you must remember that Poland was under the Soviet occupation, and Soviets wanted to avoid it. And I'm not sure that even if the extradition was performed, that those people would be sentenced, because many Nazis were not prosecuted by Polish authorities, because Polish authorities, and by Polish authorities at that moment I mean Soviet authorities, they preferred to prosecute members of the Home Army instead of prosecution of Nazis. And they even used those experience of Nazi military men to fight with the Home Army, which parts were still hiding in the woods. What we have in the result? In result, we have the situation that no military person responded for the crimes committed in Warsaw. Reinefeld made a great political career. He became a member of the Landtag. He was mayor of Westerland. As I said, Poland asked for the extradition several times of Reinefeld. And you can see in the proceedings in 50s and 60s, before the German courts, in proceedings conducted by the German prosecutor, that you could see the mocking of Polish victims. Because, for example, German prosecutor, he insisted that if claims of Polish Polish witnesses, because they were witnesses, they are biased. So we do not take into account their testimonies. Secondly, if they testified that there were some atrocities, and these atrocities were not confirmed by any German soldiers, it means that it is not reliable. And also they said that Reinefeld could not see those crimes, which is quite hard to believe, because it would be, I could argue, okay, if you, as a commander of hostilities in the center of Luxembourg, you would notice that you wouldn't notice that 40,000 people were killed, just 20,000 just during the one day, and that piles of bodies were burned. So those explanations were met with, you know, with great outrage on behalf of the Polish side. And in result, for example, when there was a 70th anniversary of the Warsaw Uprising in 2014, there was a plaque mentioning the victims of Wola Massacre and the role of Reinefeld, the Reinefeld family said that they would start legal proceeding against Warsaw Uprising Museum, that we call Reinefeld as a criminal, and he was never convicted. Yeah, so. That's why I consider that the Nuremberg trial, from the perspective of not only Poland, but also of other Eastern states, was a failure because it was a disappointment, because many crimes were not prosecuted, and the Nuremberg trial was used as an excuse for Western powers to not deal anymore with crimes committed, for example, in Warsaw, for example, in Vola. Thank you very much.
Patricia, thank you. That's very interesting. And I think the these types of lacks of prosecutions, I think, kind of enhance the argument for actions in tort by states, and which the again failed paradigm of Germany versus Italy or the other suits in tort against states for war crimes violation would enhance this argument, because in this case there's no criminal prosecution. But you do have the fact, and people have gone, so you can't really punish them criminally at some other point, but you do have the facts for further actions in tort. As for Rainer Fart, I think it's punishment enough to have that name. All right, for the third paper in this series, Dr. Luigi Prosperi will be looking at the missed Italian Nuremberg, the history of an international sponsored amnesty, and we talked about this during the break. Let me just say a few things about Luigi. Currently writing a PhD in international legal order and human rights at La Sapienza University in Rome. And also, you are a... He is with the ICSID at the moment. Luigi, the floor is yours.
Good afternoon, everybody. And first of all, let me join the chorus and thank really warmly all the organizers and Max Planck Institute, but especially those that are working behind the scenes, thanks to the technicians, everybody who's here since yesterday. And you are doing really a great job. Thank you so much. And then let me also thank Professor Bantekas and his colleagues for their commitment in the 90s, because if I have a job today, it's thanks to your commitment in the 90s, because as you can see, I'm currently working as an associate legal officer at the ICTY, at the Office of the Prosecutor in particular, and I want also to clarify that all the views, the opinions that I'm going to share with you do not necessarily reflect those of the Tribunal and of the UN in general, of course. So today I'll present you a paper on the missed prosecution of the Italian alleged war criminals after the Second World War. And let me start with giving you some context with an essential chronology. I will be very quick. So between September and October 1943, the foundations for the prosecution and punishment for the trials against the perpetrators of the crimes committed during the Second World War were laid down, in particular with the establishment of the United Nations War Crimes Commission that kicked off in February 1944. You have to think, when we talk about Italy, that it was only in May 1945, more than 1 year later, that the country would be liberated by the German occupier, from the German occupiers and from the Italian Social Republic that was, in the end, the puppet government, as we will see. 1 year later, between May and June 1946, Italy set up a national commission of inquiry that was tasked with investigating the crimes allegedly committed between 1942 and 1943 by the Italian army in Yugoslavia. And almost simultaneously, it was also adopted a national amnesty law that was called Togliatti Amnesty, because it was named after its drafter, that was at the time the Italian Minister of Justice, but most of all, and unfortunately, was the secretary of the Italian Communist Party, so the party that should have been behind the uprising, the partisan movement. In February 1947, finally, Italy signed the Treaty of Peace in Paris, and this treaty imposed the legal obligation to arrest the alleged war criminals and to surrender them to the requesting countries. However, by the end of 1947, as I wrote in a lighter tone, when I say the Italian job is done, I mean that by the end of 1947, there is no more discussion, debate about prosecuting the Italian alleged war criminals. It's no more part of the international, let alone the national agenda, and this is very sad. So if we can go on, I'm asking myself in this paper, what went wrong? Because as you can see in this peak, the second from the left is Benito Mussolini, for sure. The third, just besides Mussolini, is Badoglio, is Marshal Badoglio, that will lead in 1943 the democratic government. And the first on the right, the very tall guy, is General Rodolfo Graziani, that we'll investigate during this presentation. So, what went wrong? First of all, what went wrong was that there was an unexpected evolution, let's say, of the military situation on the ground in Italy. In fact, after the armistice was signed in September 1943, the northern areas were occupied by Germans that retreated, but occupied the northern part, so let's say, from Rome until the borders with Switzerland and France. In the south, we had an occupation as well by the Allied Allies, and in particular, the South was ruled by the so-called Allied Control Commission, that was run together by the United Kingdom and the United States of America. Behind both of them, respectively, behind the German occupation, there was the Italian Social Republic that was headed by Mussolini, that had been liberated by the Germans. And behind the Allied Control Commission, there was Badoglio's government that at the time, we are talking about the very beginning of 1944, is not a functioning government. It's a government headed by a former general, the former chief of staff of the army until 1940, and is supported by the king, but actually are the UK and the USA that are running the south of Italy, at least until February 1944, when they start relinquishing the sovereignty to Badoglio. There was a military stalemate, so it means that at the time, for some months, it was impossible for the Allies to break through the lines, the German lines. So in the north, there were the Germans, and in the south, there were the Allied. What else went wrong? The fact that the UNWCC had limited powers because it was established and mandated only to investigate and report on the alleged crimes. So the states could submit charges relating to the crimes committed during the Second World War. Then the United Nations War Crimes Commission would only investigate and find if there was a prima facie case. So it's not at all a judicial institution. We are talking just about maybe something that is similar to a fact-finding commission in the end. It took only the second half of 1946, in fact, to have the publication of the first report on the charges that Yugoslavian authorities had submitted in relation to the crimes allegedly committed by Italians during the occupation of Yugoslavia. Another big problem was that in relation to the Italo-Abyssinian War that had been fighted in 35-36, mostly 1936, at first the UNWCC had decided not to allow Ethiopia to submit charges because this war was considered outside the scope of the commission. Only after the signing of the Treaty of Peace in 1947, in February 1947, the UNWCC would take into account the charges, and we'll see how. However, the biggest obstacle was, of course, the lack of cooperation from the UK and the USA, because as we said, in 1944, there was the military stalemate in Italy, so they decided just to cooperate with the Italian army and investigating at the same time on the same persons they were collaborating with was maybe not the best political move, so they decided just not to do it for the time being. And then there was another big problem, that was the formal rejection by the USSR of the commission. So they never became a party or let alone, say, collaborate to the commission. In conclusion, by 1947, 1948, the only accomplishment, I would say, regarding Italy of the UNWCC was the assessment of the Italian high officer's liability. And in particular, I will focus on three individuals, Marshal Badoglio and General Graziani, that we saw in the peak, together with Mussolini, that were accused and in relation to whom the UNWCC found a prima facie case for the crimes committed by the Italian army during the Italo-Abyssinian War, and in particular for having ordered the use of poisonous gas and for mass murders committed in Ethiopia, and in particular in Addis Abeba, on what is called Yekatit 12 by the Ethiopians, that is the 19th of February 1937, the day when an attack against the civilian population of Addis Abeba started after an attack against General Graziani failed. And the third one was General Roatta, that was the most responsible, was considered by the UNWCC the most responsible for the crimes committed by the Italian army in Yugoslavia, and in particular the detention of an estimated 20,000 to 30,000 civilians that were held in concentration camps, in 50 concentration camps, between 1942 and 1943, and in particular in the island of Rab, that is sadly known, especially by Yugoslavian, because in Italy we don't talk about this history. So, why failure? First of all, yeah, this is the embodiment of the failure, because on your left you can see a mausoleum dedicated to General Graziani, that is a war hero, as you can see. And this is a village close to Rome. I have to say, to be fair, that this mausoleum is usually the target of writers' attacks, and I'm happy to say it. And this is the only pic I could find without writings on it. So usually there's something like a killer or something like that on the mausoleum. On your right, you can see a plaque that is hanging in a square, is on a public building, is dedicated to Marshal Badoglio by his hometown, that is called Grazzano Badoglio. Today has the name, is named after Badoglio, was named during the fascist regime after Badoglio, and is still called Grazzano Badoglio. So, what I want to try to answer now is another question. Why do I say that is also a failure of the international community, not only of the national community? First of all, because the international community, in my opinion, has responsibilities in relation to the non-enforcement of treaties, of provisions that were set up, and in particular in the instrument of surrender of Italy that was signed on the 29th of September 1943, because as you can see, Article 29 was pretty clear and provided that all listed persons shall be surrendered to the UN. At the time, you have to take into account that the UNWCC was being established, so the idea was that the UNWCC would list persons and then Italian authorities should have arrested and surrendered them to the UN. On the 30th of October 1943, in the declaration regarding Italy, that is annexed to the Moscow Declaration, so this one was signed also by the USSR, he said one of the principles is that suspected fascist leaders and army generals also, shall be handed over to justice. And this was very broad. This was also exploited in a certain sense by Italian authorities, saying that to justice means every kind of justice. On the 10th of February 1947, Italy signed the Treaty of Peace in Paris, which Article 38 provided the inclusion of the crimes related to the Italo-Abyssinian War in the concept of the prosecution. And in particular, as to the alleged war criminals, it was established by Article 45 that all the accused of war crimes or crimes against humanity shall be surrendered for trial. And this surrendered makes clear that we are talking about a surrender to a foreign country. But what happened immediately afterwards? The Treaty of Peace entered into force for Italy in September 1947. Less than 1 year afterwards, US decided to formally renounce the application, so the enforcement of Article 45. Was then followed by the UK in April 48. So they decided that they will never pressure Italian authorities to arrest and surrender the alleged war criminals. And then also France and Greece joined this group, but it was not by formal renunciation. In this case, it was a political decision not to enforce the provision. So another failure, in my opinion, is also the failure to provide redress to victims. General Graziani would be convicted as Nazi collaborator, not for crimes, not for being responsible of crimes committed during the war, only because he joined the Italian Social Republic after 43. And then, after being convicted, 4 months later, he was granted amnesty, 4 months later. Marshal Badoglio would be expelled from the Senate because he had been a collaborator of the former regime until 1940, but was never charged with any crime. So he died as a free man. As to General Roatta, and this is pretty hilarious, actually, the story, because General Roatta was convicted in absentia in 1945, because by the time the trial was held, he had evaded from a military hospital where he had been sent because he was so ill that then, during the night, he could escape. But then, thanks to an amnesty, he was acquitted, but he never knew about the acquittal, so he remained a fugitive until 1966, when he went back to Italy and everybody told him, well, where were you? Come on, we are friends. So what happened? Then another unfortunate episode was the adoption of Togliatti amnesty, as I told you, in June 1946, because due to the adoption of this amnesty and the entering into force, the application by the extremely broad application by the Court of Cassation must be said, the result was that hundreds of convicted former fascists and Nazis collaborators had been acquitted on the third instance by the Court of Cassation after having been convicted in the first two instances. So they were freed, and we are talking about hundreds of persons. There aren't figures, official figures, because nobody knows how many of them. And in the end, what else happened? That Yugoslavian and the Ethiopian efforts have been undermined by the United Kingdom between 1947 and 1948, because arrest warrants had been issued by Yugoslavia and Ethiopia, but they were never executed because the Allied powers decided, as we said, the USA by the time had already renounced the application of Article 45. There was the UK, but the UK decided not to pressure Italy. And the third reason why I talk about there's one slide missing. I don't know why. Okay, yeah, not a problem. So another responsibility, and this is slightly, now I'm slightly moving from the international law perspective. This is more, let's say, a social perspective. I think that there's also a contribution to a misrepresentation, because when in 1944 the Allies decided not to push for removal of bad apples from the Italian army, they certainly, for sure, contributed to the let's say, this forced reconciliation in Italy. They were just saying, we need the army, so we won't prosecute them, and that's it. Then, secondly, I would say that in 1945, when the UNWCC allowed Italians to submit charges, formally submit charges, so presenting themselves as victims in front, besides the UNWCC, they allowed them to present Italians as victims. So there were no more perpetrators. By the summer of 1945, as I told you, Ethiopia was still not allowed to submit charges, but Italy was allowed. So Italy, at that point, for the international community, was a victim of the Nazis. And then another problem is that, in the end, I think that the fact that it was not protested, the creation of the National Commission of Inquiry and the adoption of the Togliatti amnesty, by not protesting these instruments, in the end, the Allies contributed to the expulsion of fascist crimes from national tribunals. So not only they are not prosecuted by international tribunals, but at this point, they are also outside the national judiciary. So there are no fascist crimes anymore in the national agenda, in the debate. So in conclusion, this is only an opinion, and also on a lighter tone, I would say that the international community, I think that this story, the misprosecution of the Italian war criminals, is a failure also of the international community, because it was agreed upon in the end, upon the perpetuation of a myth. And I would also say that Italy, in the end, was allowed to build a democratic country on a post-truth foundation, because this is the world of 2016. So it's really a post-truth foundation, because it was also celebrated by the movie industry from 1965, when a movie called Italiani Brava Gente, Italians Good People, was shot, until 2000, when Captain Scorelli Mandolin was shot. We are perpetuating this myth of the good Italians that, in conclusion, can't commit crimes, because, you know, we are victims, we are not perpetrators. Thank you.
Very interesting, because most people, if you ask people in Greece, for example, what they think about the Italian occupation of Greece, you know, there's an obvious rise in the sale of guitars at the end of the war, because people took it up. And so they find that the occupation was innocuous compared to the Germans.
In most areas.
In most areas.
In most areas.
Yeah.
So.
Oh, really?
Very few, but yeah.
So we took up football as well after that. But I think one of the things that I think has been missing for a long time from the international literature, and I think maybe the Max Planck would be interested in doing something about it, is the collecting all those war crimes trials, many of which have not been recorded, and many of which are quite rudimentary, very, very basic. For example, in the Soviet Union, other parts of the world that we have no access to, and, you know, in China and so forth. And, you know, collecting all this together would maybe show a better picture of what was done, what impunity looked like. I don't know if in Poland there were any trials for subsequent to these people. And so collecting all this together, you know, with a sound translation would be maybe something worthwhile, but I think it's even larger than all the projects that you're undertaking at the moment. So let's have a Q&A for a while, and then we can... Sergey? men first, is it?
Have I got it? Is it on, first of all? Yeah. I just want to make comment, and it's largely, I think, directed to the second paper, which is, I think we have to be quite careful when we engage in, I don't know what I'd call it, victimology, because it's a sort of, and comparative suffering, because it's a very unfortunate truth that prosecutions always tend to be dictated by national priorities. And if we're going to engage in comparative victimology, everyone has their favorite unpunished massacre. So we could say, for example, I don't know, the rape of Nanking, up to 300,000 people killed. I'm not going to engage in comparative atrocity, so I won't go into details. And then at the end of the war, the ranking officer, Prince Asaki, is not is granted immunity. He's not prosecuted at all. And I think what I'm trying to say, and of course with the rape of Nanking, we actually have a situation where very high officials within the Japanese government have continued to deny the existence of the atrocity ever since. So I think that, you know, the concentration on who were the victims and is important, but we shouldn't forget and we shouldn't use that to avoid questions of complicity and perpetration. And I'm afraid that that is sometimes what happens. And I think, you know, and I'm not going to say anything more about recent developments in legislation in Poland, but I think it is something that we do have to be careful about.
Okay, that chap is Matthew Happel. So the next person, please state their name as well. Who was it? Sergey.
Bravissimo. Thank you very much for your very passionate presentations, which is especially important for the after-lunch panel. So I have a general question to all of you. I would like to invite you to reflect on the reasons for which we are turning increasingly to history and historiography of international criminal law. Why are we doing that? What is our agenda? Perhaps it is a very personal question, and you have would have your personal answers. Does it perhaps have something to do with the place where we are at this moment with the project of international criminal law? So what is the agenda? That's perhaps a very methodological question. And I have a specific question for you, Patricia. What would you make of the failure of the IMT to make mention of the Katyn massacre? So the mass murder of 40,000 Polish officers, which was committed by the NKVD, by the Soviets, and the Soviets subsequently acknowledged it some decades after there was a parliamentary statement. But the IMT simply did not mention this incident at all, although the evidence was led during the Nuremberg trial, trying to put the blame on the Nazis. So do you consider this a major debacle or failure, or is it something that you can rationalize with reference to the jurisdictional limitations of the IMT? Because it was, of course, unthinkable that it would even try to exercise jurisdiction over the Allied powers. How do you feel about it? Thank you.
Thank you. Yael Wierzman. Perhaps a question to jump off from, to take off from Sergei on the historical perspective, because I'm interested in the forward-looking perspective, and so sometimes we look to the past in order to look forwards. And so my question is for Luigi, even though you could all perhaps reflect in your own areas of interest. Luigi, would you have any insights on how, what were the effects on Italian society of this sort of amnesia, the reputation of being the good Italian, without trying to be provocative at all, but could it have had any positive aspects? And also the retroactive sort of release, acquittal of due to the amnesty law, of hundreds and hundreds. You said it was not recorded, but is there any way of seeing what the effects were of these releases of these hundreds of people? Did they any take any key positions in Italy, Italy in the aftermath of the Second World War, etc.? Thank you.
Did you want to go? No. Okay, Moshe.
Just to follow very quickly, Sergei, I think one of the important functions of courts is to lay out historical narratives. In many cases, it's the most important things for the victims. And Katyn massacre is a wonderful example. Actually, the European Court of Human Rights somewhat compensated, made it up in its two decisions and the recent one by the Grand Chamber. There are five or six pages about the Katyn massacre, citing Russian documents. And that's it.
So I have a question for Luigi and a question for the first speaker. Sorry, I didn't pick up your name. Igin, yeah, thanks. So for Luigi, I have this question. So I'm Italian myself, and I'm very, very interested in your presentation. I want to ask you, you know, there's been a lot of discussion about Nazi criminals that have escaped basically after Nuremberg, and that nobody has done anything about them, or the international community didn't put any effort to actually capture them. And Simon Wiesenthal wrote a very interesting book on that in all details. So I want to ask you whether you think this Italian case that you talked about, it's an Italian exception, or if you think that the international community generally was not interested in finding these criminals because it preferred to have political stability in Europe, etc. And said for you, I wanted to ask you, it's often said that the Tokyo Tribunal was a failure, especially in comparison with the Nuremberg Tribunal, because Japan has not recognized, like Germany did, the massacres, especially in China, that were going on. I wanted to ask you, do you think if there would have been no tribunal at all, this would have changed and the attitude in Asia would have been different toward these massacres? Thank you very much.
One final question from the gentleman in the back.
Uh, Thank you. My name is Remy Jorsma, research fellow at MPI. Thanks to all three of you for your fascinating presentations. I had a question and a comment to Professor Zsibik. Patricia, if I may, I think I may. We go back a little bit. The comment, so I think I had a bit of a difficulty with the qualification of the Wola massacre as sort of the biggest single crime committed during the World War. I think it needs a qualification that it's done by the Axis powers, because arguably the biggest crime has been committed by the Allies in Japan in the form of two bombs. So that may be a little bit of a comment. More importantly, a question though, has there been any effort in Poland after your regained independence to sort of catch up with the lack of prosecution of German war criminals under the basis of universal jurisdiction, like is happening still right now in Germany when it comes to very old people in wheelchairs who are still being prosecuted? I was wondering if any effort has been done. Okay, yeah, thanks. Well, okay. The answer has been given, but I would like to hear the answer from you.
Can we just,
thanks.
Because we're just, we're way past the 3 o'clock mark, can we have, say, 4.5 minutes each? let's start with Patricia.
Okay, so thank you for the questions. All the questions were fascinating and provoking much more research on my side. Firstly, certainly there is some, always prosecutor must have some priorities, and he cannot deal, like in Nuremberg, they could not deal with all crimes. Yes, but my claim is that they unnecessarily, they were focusing on the proving that the war was aggressive one, whether, for example, for victims, the more important question was to deal with a specific massacre, specific crimes against civilians, just to deal, for example, with Holocaust to the greater extent and not to analyze what kind of treaties were violated and if Brandt-Kellogg Pact was valid or not valid. Concerning historiography, I think that, firstly, in case of Poland, and I think of all other Eastern countries, you must also remember that till 1990, some research could not be done. So for example, about Wola massacre in Poland, there were first monographs, first articles published just 1-2 years ago. And people were not, now we were starting, you know, just to collect some testimonies of the victims and some evidence, because previously we could not talk about crimes committed during the Warsaw Uprising, because till 1990, the Warsaw Uprising was perceived as the action of bandits. Yeah, so that's why maybe there was no so much focus on the different crimes. Certainly, also the you mentioned the cutting case. Yeah, William Szabas just asked me that we should be satisfied because during few days Poland was the priority for the Nuremberg trial because cutting massacre was discussed. But we must remember that it was discussed because Soviet wanted to discuss it and Soviet wanted to accuse of accuse Nazis of this crime. So for Poland, this is not satisfied because the truth was not revealed. The truth was covered in Nuremberg. Fortunately, allies, they knew who committed the crime, and that's why the case was dropped. Yeah. Also, you've asked about why we should look into the past. Why shouldn't we look maybe for the to the future? Yeah. I think that firstly, maybe just how Professor Bantekas mentioned, maybe it's worth to investigate national judgments, national investigations, because I think that we focus too much on Nuremberg proceeding, where there are other countries, they were also struggling with the prosecution of war crimes, and their experience can be very valuable for us. For example, the first verdicts and with great analysis concerning crimes against peace, concerning aggression, were issued by Polish courts before the Nuremberg verdict. The first judgments in which genocide was mentioned and what was judged were Polish judgments. It was in 1946-47. So I think that we can teach a lot from the jurisprudence of different countries, not only of the big ones. And also, as Moshe said, for example, for Polish victims, the problem is of satisfaction and of statement of some truth. That, for example, you mentioned Katyn case, but when you look on the proceedings before the Grand Chamber of European Court of Human Rights, you could see that Russian representatives, they were saying, oh, we do not know what happened with those officers. Maybe they are still missing. Maybe they are just waiting in the woods. So if you hear something like this after, you know, 70 more years, then you see that there's still problem to admit some facts, and it's still crucial for the families. And also with Katyn massacre, I must stress that after the Second World War, the families of those who were killed in Katyn, I know I see this hand, they were persecuted, and they could not make any career in Poland, and they could not talk about this massacre. And just to answer Remy's question, to not leave him, I just wanted to say, yes, I have the problem with this biggest crime, because we can calculate which was the biggest one and so on, but I must stress the two things. Firstly, we were estimating, like, for example, number of victims based on ashes after the Second World War, and in Reinefeld proceedings, they were saying that our estimates, that these ashes are too small to talk about such amount of the victims. But I think that the crucial is that not that Reinefeld was guilty of 43,000 or 41,000, but that he was guilty of killing thousands of people, so this was for sure crime against humanity. And yes, after 1990, in Poland, in the Institute of Polish Remembrance, there is investigation concerning crimes committed during the Warsaw Uprising. Of course, perpetrators in majority are dead, and this proceeding for in future would not be...
One more minute and there's water.
Yeah, but I just wanted to say that what is important, we just say that we just need to have a list of all victims and of all perpetrators, not to prosecute them, but just to know the truth.
Had I known, I wouldn't have asked you to go first. Heijing, can you go next?
So briefly about your question about, so no tribunal at all would have been better choice for that. I don't think so, because still Tokyo Tribunal has a symbolic importance that the atrocities had happened in this region. And also the failure or illusions about this having this tribunal can be a starting point of discussion that... So having impunity has a major impact on the victims' community and the state's attitude towards justice projects. So I think it has still importance.
I love you. Okay, you go now. Luigi.
Okay.
Try to be loved too.
I want to be loved, yeah. Okay. So... I will try to give sort of tweets, because I love Twitter, so I'll try to be very brief, and then I will be glad to continue outside during the break. First, why turn into history? What's the agenda? Fun answer is, because my supervisor told me, don't submit that paper, no, please. So I was like, yeah, I will. And this is dedicated to Olivier, that yesterday said something similar. I join him. Serious answer is, because I would love to analyze, to investigate the blind spots. Because I think that sometimes we are the first applying a double standard. So in this moment, it's important to get back to history, because we are all criticizing the African states for the withdrawals. We are criticizing what's happening in Syria. But when was our turn? When we had the potential, the possibility to prosecute, we selected. We will prosecute this side, not this side. We need Italy, because Italy is in the middle of the Mediterranean. I'm answering now to the second, and together with the third. I'm not an expert. I come from a political science department, but I have a law degree, but I still love reading and reading also other stuff, so coming from other experts and researchers. So I would say that Italy was in the middle of the Mediterranean, the Balkans, were, let's say, leaning towards USSR. So for UK and US was super important to have Italy on their side. And there are exchanges, there are letters, there are official documents, especially from the UN, the UK Foreign Office, saying that Italians are very important. And to prosecute Italians could have, let's say, backfired the British expectations towards Italy, especially because they remember that the Italian Communist Party was super strong at the time. And the only way to get Italy not taking the left side was to have them as strong allies. And to have them as strong allies meant also giving them money, supporting them, and avoiding any diplomatic issue. So that was the first aim. The effects on Italian society, I'm not an expert as well, but I would say that the first effect is that after 70 years, we still have a polarized society for everything. It's always black or white, left or right. It is impossible to have an in-depth analysis of something, a thoughtful assessment, trying not to be a left-winger or a right-winger, because we never overcame the fascist regime, the fight between the partisans and the fascists. There's no way. And until we go through this kind of history, these events, I think that we'll never overcome. I have also a final one. This is fun as well. I have an history. I have a story, and I know it thanks to a friend. This friend's father was working for the Italian railway company, the national company. So in the 80s, there's one day when our president of the Republic, Sandro Pertini, that maybe most of you remember for the celebration of the Italian goals in Spain at the World Cup, the very old guy with the white hair and the pipe. And this man, our president, was super frightened by planes, was never taking planes. One day he has to go to Milan, and so he had a train only for him. So he gets to Milan, arrives in Milan, he's on the train, and they tell him, look, the mayor couldn't come, there's the chief of police outside waiting for you. And he goes like, no, I'm not getting down this train because the man was a fascist. And we are in the 80s, he's almost 40 years afterwards. He was a socialist during the war, he was exiled, he was on an island, and for years he remembered this guy because this guy signed the order sending him in exile. So he was like, I'm not getting down the train. He was on the train for 3 hours until they told the chief of police, yeah, okay, just leave the station and let him get down and let us go home, please. So these are the effects, the kind of effects. You have these guys that are authorized, that stays, work, have, I mean, they are the chief of police. They will go on. They are policemen. They will go on being policemen. So that's the main effect, I would say. That's it. It's sad, sorry. But yeah.
I like you, but I don't love you. Express all around.